This is a podcast 75 years in the making. It's a podcast about history.
Bring pork chops and applesauce.
It's a podcast about family.
The love is deep for her.
But most importantly, it's a podcast about you.
Sounds kind of weird.
It's season 3 of the official Holiday World Podcast, chronicling our 75th year of family fun.
Friends, welcome back to season 3 of the official Holiday World podcast. This is season 3, episode 14, the one with 75 years of vision. Today is Monday, July 12th for us, but we expect to release this episode July 26th. Welcome, Pod Squad. I'm going to start off with Matt Eckert. Welcome back. You've been on hiatus.
I have been on hiatus. Glad to be back.
It's great to have you. Lauren Crosby, welcome back.
I am here, although I don't know if my mind made it.
We'll let you know.
Lauren's got a baby girl who decided to
have an all-night rager last night, and she thought I needed to be there for it, too.
Well, isn't that sweet of her to include you, though?
I know.
Are you saying your rager days are over?
Yes. Yes, I am.
Confirmed.
And then, like, what little sleep I did get, it was in a recliner holding her, so.
Neat.
16 months, apparently still needs her mom.
Aww,
I mean,
she's adorable.
I'm over 30 and I still need my mom.
Yeah, fair.
But does she hold you and sleep in a recliner?
If I requested it, she might. She might have some questions, but.
Like, and we want photos of that.
And right? With that introduction, Sabrina, everybody.
Howdy.
Hi, Mom.
And of course,
who listens? And of course, welcome back, Nell, from the Santa Claus Museum and Village.
Hello.
Oh, it's so great to have you guys back, and so great to be back on a nice, rainy July Monday. Isn't that lovely?
It is. We've been lucky, though, this summer. Yeah. The weather's been really, really good this season. Yeah. So
even if it starts out rainy, it ends nice.
So I'm not going to complain about the rain.
Yeah.
It's not 2020.
Yep.
No. And we're busy, busy, busy when it rains because they need something to do.
Yeah.
So we are really busy. Again,
you're welcome.
Lemonades.
That's
lemonade
right.
Out of lemons.
Lemonade.
Yep. There you go.
Yep.
All righty. Well, we've got a lot on the agenda today, so I'm going to hop right in. First of all, I want to talk about a post that recently went viral. We have someone named Natalie. I'm not going to include her last name. I'm sure many of you have seen this post on Facebook. She said, if you've never been to Holiday World in Santa Claus, Indiana, I strongly recommend you going. Literally endless things to do for children of all ages, adults too. Not only are there 6 theme parks in one, I appreciate her giving us credit.
Yeah, I do too.
On
I like
each
that
section.
Part.
Thank you. Yeah. Uh-huh. But there's free and limited soft drinks and sunscreen stations everywhere and free parking. There's also a little diss of the Wisconsin Dells that I won't dive too deeply into. But this post I checked today has 60,000 shares on it.
Oh my gosh.
She's like a regular person. I'm still trying to figure out how Facebook works. And like, she just broke it.
Yep.
I don't understand. How do you break the internet like that?
She did it.
She's Wreck-It Ralph.
Sorry.
Well,
I appreciate I that.
Yep.
I've seen both of them.
Yeah, same.
It's amazing. But yeah, I just wanted to call that out because like, I mean, Sabrina, you had the inbox that day that all the traffic started. Actually, I had it the first night.
Yeah,
I Leah was watching our Facebook inbox and I went to bed finally because I was like, I can't handle this. Like, and they just keep coming. Mm-hmm. And so finally in the morning, I had to be like, Sabrina, I'm really sorry about the inbox.
It was like, you were like, I'm sorry about the inbox. And my brain went to like, what happened? Like,
Leah, did you leave me like a nasty gram in there? No.
No. And it was
or maybe,
like,
I don't know. There's so much in there.
And usually whenever, you know, people message us in the inbox, it's like, how much are tickets? It's like, these were, where are you? I have never heard of you before.
Yeah.
Where is this located?
Yeah.
And we're like, so we got to introduce ourselves to an entirely new audience. So it was really
exciting. Yeah. We put up a post about where to stay and just kind of watched all the, like, our Facebook likes increased by 30,000 during that time. Like,
wow.
We had so many people watching us. We're very,
So thank you.
So thank you, Natalie.
She'd be getting something.
We offered her 8 tickets to return this year or next year.
So do you know, were you able to tell where she's from?
Earlier, she's locked down a lot of privacy. I think somewhere in the Quincy, Illinois area.
Okay.
But not positive. All I know is that Chicago really caught hold of it based on our live Google Analytics. And Detroit really picked up on it. And Philadelphia was in on the action too. go figure.
That one's odd.
That is very odd.
Yeah.
You show that to me like, what?
Yeah.
Like and everyone's like, this is only 5 hours away. This is only 4 hours away. Yeah, like, it was all like within a 5-hour-ish range of us.
I always like to ask people when they come in, so did you just see Santa Claus on the side of the road?
Uh-huh.
Or did you plan on stopping here?
Yeah.
Are you here because you were at Holiday World one day and you came to see us another day? It is amazing how many people just see Santa Claus on the side of the road and they just turn.
They just have to see it.
Seriously.
Yeah.
I mean,
I don't know that I would.
I have only once ever, I'm a very plan.
Me too. Yep. And like, when I go somewhere, I'm on a mission.
Me too.
Yep. Yep.
My son had a job in Wyoming and I rode with him from Oklahoma to Wyoming. And I said, we're just going to, whatever we see, we want to stop and see. We did. That was the only time I've ever done that. And so we stopped and
did it like drive you nuts or
that
sounds like
adventurous.
Fun to me. Cause I don't plan for anything. So
I planned everything like to the second.
Lauren's just broken.
Lauren is like the queen of planning.
Yeah. It was kind of a liberating. And like we were in Denver. I saw a friend and he had to go for his job. Mm-hmm. And I said, hey, there's a Rockies game tonight. Should we just stay and go to the Rockies game? And he loves baseball. So he was like, sure. So we went to the Rockies game and
nice.
This lady stopped us on the road, on the street that night. And she said, are you here is that your son? And I said, yes. And she came up and hugged me. And she said, that's so wonderful that you're spending quality time with your son.
That's so sweet.
I know. I was like, thanks.
I bet you planned the next trip though, didn't you?
Oh, for sure. Yeah. My husband, Dave, couldn't believe it. He's like, you just stopped? And I said, yes, I did.
Who are you?
I feel like they're like, there are three types of people, maybe. I was going to say two types, but like there's like the hyper planners or the people who do that. But you're both, and I'm neither. So I'm not really sure what that means for a... most people are like, but I'm a sit back and let Lauren organize our trip type of person though too, because we've got the organizer.
Right.
And
my family does that too.
Anything I try to organize just gets in the way of her organizing. So I just don't.
Yep. I said, just give me the credit card.
Yep. Yep.
I'll let you know what we're doing.
Exactly.
I've just gotten so used to no one planning anything and that drives me nuts. So I've just taken over. And now,
me too.
Now no one else can do anything because I,
that's
like,
how
no,
I am
it's
too.
Mine now.
Yeah.
And they wouldn't do it well enough if they tried.
Well, yeah.
Yes.
Right. Exactly. My brother has 9 in his family because it's a his, hers, theirs. So to find a place to stay is pretty difficult. So when I do, I'm like, thank you. That was a great call by me. Thanks, everyone. Yes. Yeah, I did a good job. Yes.
Wow.
It's hard.
Yeah. I don't know where we left off on this, but the viral post. Wow.
Right?
Once again, we're very good at getting off topic.
Yeah,
we had to ask Natalie, did they plan it? Like, how much did they plan it? Like, did she, you know?
Oh, her visit. Yeah. I wonder if it was like a.
How did she find out about it?
Was this her first time? Had she been here before?
I mean, last time someone went viral, it was Max Kennedy on TikTok, and we had him on. We should probably
try to get Natalie
on the call. We'll see about that. But congratulations, Natalie, on a huge post.
And she's, thank you.
Thank you. She's also making new recommendations for her fans, so
nice.
Check it out. I mean, by all means, turn this into something.
Hey,
you get 60,000 shares on something, go for it.
Something figured out.
I don't think we can get that on our page.
Right. Facebook's got us locked down. So
that's
fine.
Yeah, Facebook doesn't like businesses.
That's okay.
That's probably for the best. I don't need my news feed
all businesses.
Cluttered with all the businesses I follow.
Fair.
All righty. And now moving on. This podcast is airing July 26th, and our birthday is August 3rd.
Hey.
So it's like next week.
Oh, yes.
Wow.
My brain is not there yet.
Yeah.
No.
A little over a week.
A week and one day.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Close enough.
What I want to call out right now is that if you can, I highly recommend being in the park on that day. We've got some surprises ready for you guys. We're going to have a ceremony. We'll post a little closer to that day, what exactly that time will be. But we've got some treats planned for everyone who comes, the first 5,000 people who come through the front gate. We've got some prizes. And we'll have some treats if you attend our ceremony, I believe. So,
hey.
It's going to be exciting. What are you guys thinking about August 3rd? Are you guys excited?
I'm excited. It's very humbling, too, that we've been in business now for 75 years. And we've grown so much, but I still feel like we're the same park we were when we started. Mm-hmm. Just bigger.
still just quirky and charming
just
as ever.
Quirky and charming as ever. That's right. And we will keep being quirky and charming.
Yep.
It is pretty amazing.
Yeah. I feel like this segues nicely into what I was going to talk about this episode anyway. So I'm just going to dive straight across and we'll talk about other things later. But this episode, I really wanted to take the time to talk about the big moves that shaped Holiday World and Splashin Safari into what it is today. So I know I've been thinking on this question for a long time, and now I'm going to put you guys on the spot. If you had to pick, aside from opening Santa Claus Land in 1946, what do you think the biggest move is that made Holiday World what it is today?
You want me to go first?
Go for it.
All right.
Whoever's got an answer. Matt always has an answer.
I always have an answer. So I would
say... He always has two answers.
I do.
Yeah. He always has a monologue. Okay, isn't that what I told you before?
Yeah. So I just had a second come to mind now. So so I would say the year 2000. So I just added this part. That's the year I started. So I would say that was a big move for us. Really the year 2000, because that is the year we started doing the unlimited free soft drinks. Mm-hmm. And I think that that truly defined who we are as a company and as a park, because that's such a strong value message to our guests. We were already doing free parking. We were already, you know, but to make that big of a leap, and I think I've told the story here on the podcast before, but that was the year I started, and that's one of the first things Will came to talk to me about. He's like, hey, I got this great idea. I want to start doing free unlimited soft drinks. Having just started, I looked at him and said, are you stupid? Like, really? Like, no. I'm like,
the first, wasn't the last. Right.
I'm like, have you seen, like, how much, you know, profit
what we make on it?
Yeah.
I mean, yeah.
A lot, you know.
Everyone but he's in like, the industry says.
Right. But he's like, no, hear me out. And he, like, started, like, going through
it
all
of the
pros. It's
a very low-cost item. Yeah.
And benefits of doing this. I'm like, okay, you're the boss. We'll do it. And I think it was the best decision we've ever made.
That is a thing that, like, you know, when we go back and talk about Natalie's post, I just think that, you know, we invented viral marketing in so many ways.
We did.
I mean, pat on the back for us.
And like you said, that first year going to our trade association show, everybody was coming up to us saying, why are you doing this? This is crazy. The very next year, they were coming up to us saying,
how do you do this?
Yeah. How do we do this at our park?
Like, and we received an award for that promotion.
We did.
Yeah.
We did.
The brass rings at IAPA.
Yep. So.
It's not nothing.
I think that was a big turning point for us, for sure.
I thought you had two answers.
Well, the other one's hiring me.
Yeah. Oh.
That year.
Okay.
I added that one since Steven said I had to have a second one.
I do, though. People, obviously we get tons of people. We're a side item to Holiday World. And so when they come in.
You're a supplement.
Complimentary products.
There you go. And so, you know, usually they're before Holiday World opens or after they've had, you know, the day there, they come and do the stuff in the town the next day. But so just last week, a family came and they said, we are so glad that it's still modesty, you know, that it's still family values. And that's huge. I mean, they said, we'll drive the extra whatever. We live in Ohio and we don't want to go to those parks. We want to come over here.
Oh.
I hear that all the time. So I think just keeping with the original values is huge.
Are you going around the table or can I interject?
Go ahead, please.
I know that I don't have as much latitude to speak because I've only been around for 7 years, but I've kind of had the opportunity by being with Paula and digging into history some and
I feel
looking
like you
at
know
archives.
More history than me.
Yeah.
I have to say, I want to say it was when the Raven was built.
No, you took mine.
Sorry.
That one's up there for me, too.
I feel like when the Raven was built, that was what really put a target on Holiday World's back. Like, we're coming for the big boys now. Like, we're not just a family park. We are going to be a thrill park for families. And I think that was a really smart move. It's a great coaster. It's still a great coaster. I really feel like that was kind of the turning point, because then all the other dominoes start to fall. Legend a few years later, Voyage a few years later. Now we have Thunderbird. I mean, you can start to see the progression of where the park is going, and it's pretty cool to be in the middle of.
I was thinking along the same lines, because I feel like my answer ties in nicely to yours. To me, what sparks the Raven, though, is Frightful Falls in 1984. Before that, we had had some kind of, you know, mostly kind of carnival type mm-hmm. rides, things that, you know, we had made into more of an installation than just a regular carnival, but mostly just things that you could find at any, you know, amusement park. And I think Frightful Falls was kind of that first installed ride. Even though as we look back on it now, it's not really themed as, you know, most of the themed amusement industry has become, but like it was a step in the right direction on theming. And 1984 is also the year that, you know, we turn into Holiday World. Mm-hmm. And I just think that those two together, I think that that attraction really kicked off that, oh, okay, so a bigger ride makes a bigger punch. And so then you see Raging Rapids in 1990, and then you see Splashin Safari in 93, and then you see the Raven in 95. So I agree with that sentiment, but I'm going to counter and say I think 1984 kicked it off. We just, but I mean, I'm also going to go, I'll let other people in interject a second, sorry. But I'm also going to say in 2000, I think that's when we really kicked off that period of just every year something new came. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, I mean...
And we've shown that it doesn't always have to be a new ride either.
Yeah.
You know, it can be a new promotion or a new concept or a new value mm-hmm. that we've added. You know, we added free sunscreen, mm-hmm. you know, shortly after that. That was a great value add. It was
exactly.
something, you know, those kinds of things, those make a difference.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly. Leah already said it, but she didn't say it like it was a big deal, but Splash and Safari.
Oh, yeah.
It is I feel like a I don't huge even think about part of who we are.
Yeah. Yes.
It is a big, big draw for us. So the we opening actually, of Splash and Safari.
We were just named the number 3 water park in the United States by USA Today 10 Best. And I never say it correctly. I say Fodders or Foders, however you say it.
I always say Foders, but I
like to say
right.
it Foders because I said that I say that's how you say folder in our area. Would or you like, name me that Foder?
Or like Hodor.
Foder and Foder Hodor.
I say that with love, everybody. I say that with love.
Sorry.
I say Foders because there's voters, so...
Yeah.
Kind of. And I'll be the nerd off of Game of Thrones, Hodor.
Nice.
It's Fodor.
Fodor. Anyway, they named us the number 2 water park in the country.
Hey.
Yeah. It's great to see some of those accolades come in. Yeah. But yeah, Sabrina, did you want to add to the? I know Stephen took your
totally
answer.
Took mine.
When you go last, it's hard because we take out the good ones.
Handed out some timelines.
Rude.
To everyone but Sabrina. Actually, Matt and Lauren, if you guys can share.
Rude.
Oh, I knew I was going to do that.
Fail.
I can reach it.
I attempted to. Stephen, I hope you keep every second of that in. I attempted to pass across the table and we still have our social distance set up going, so... You know, I'm really with it.
Okay. So I was definitely going to say Raven because I remember as a kid, like, I can't remember if it was like a conversation I heard, but people were like, oh, Holiday World's becoming a thrill park now. Like, they're changing who they are. And then, like, it was just an awesome coaster and it just really added to it. And then, too, I remember walking in a Splash and Safari the first time being like, you know, and I like the value it adds to it now. Like now we know like what, like how full the park gets as soon as, you know, people think, oh, it's hot outside, time to go to Holiday World and go swim. So like, you know, I don't know. Like I feel like the combination of Splash and Safari, Raven, and then like the free soft drinks too. I mean, the value that that adds. And like you guys said too, you know, that people, I don't remember what year it was. We got the best value park. Midwest Value.
A few years on and off and from a couple different organizations even. We're always ranked in the top, if not the top, value park in the nation as well.
And that's such like a Midwestern value too, of like value and like using your money well and like, and I don't know. I just think that makes it something awesome that, you know, we can contribute to our state and area.
So now that we've, you know, kind of made our theories on what the one big thing is, I want to go back and kind of talk through some of the things that maybe weren't quite as big, but I think there's so many small things that without it, we just don't turn into the same park we are today. What do you think? You with me?
Yeah.
Are you going through all of these?
No, I'm not going through everything.
I was like,
I just wanted like a...
I thought this was supposed to be a short
a little
podcast.
Reference. A little reference. First of all, I want to call out that by having an attraction, the kids train when we first opened, it does, I haven't read Jim Futrell's chapter yet in our 75th book. And we're going to talk about that in the next episode, I hope. Hey. But, you know, I mean, by having a ride there right from the beginning that shapes us, starts to shape us into an amusement park already. And we add the Freedom Train shortly after. I told you guys about this, right? The Freedom Train wasn't actually there on the first day. It came a little later, but yeah. And then you add the Jeep go around.
There were production delays.
Yes. It was a train enthusiast who was making it, which still fascinates me.
Just passionate about trains.
And a train that lasted us, you know,
through
2013.
Time.
I mean, man, that was a hard year to say goodbye to that. But anyway, I want to talk too about, you know, the Christmas room. I think Nell, before you had talked about how, you know, the rides were just there for the kids after you ate dinner.
People would come for lunch. A lady came in just this week and she said, oh, it just looks so much different over there. And she spent a lot of time in the museum and looking at pictures. And she said, we used to come and eat. And she said, I was a baked Alaska person.
Aww.
And so she definitely talked about that she had to have her baked Alaska.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah. It's fun to hear the people that come in and like shed a tear in her eye. Yeah. I mean, you know, that they have like really good memories.
Yeah. I love that.
Yeah.
But yeah, we opened the Christmas room in 1948, and it's not really until 1955 that, you know, we talked about Pleasureland in this last episode, but, you know, we had a bunch of kid rides that year. But I also think it's interesting that in kind of there's this period of time where really it's just kind of shows and things like that that get added to the park to be a draw. So there's the Willie Bartley ski show. And we had someone come in to the museum for that as well.
It was her wedding anniversary. And she said, her husband said, what do you want to do today? And she said, you know, I'm going to go to Santa Claus. It had really good memories for her. Uh-huh. And she lived with the Bartleys.
Oh, that's okay.
So she said she was coming out of the grocery store. Where did she? Elnora. She's from Elnora.
Okay.
And there was a person talking about the skiing. And that's how she got involved. She said, I could water ski with like the big wooden skis. Uh-huh. You know, she said, I couldn't slalom. But she came and she tried out and she lived with them. I guess they rented a place in Ferdinand and she lived there with them in the summers.
Wow.
I think she said she did 2 summers. And then she said, then I decided I had to get serious and go to school. But she and her husband had been married like 60 years.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. So she's cool. Really neat. And so her picture is in our book.
Uh-huh.
And so I took a picture of her with her picture.
I love that.
Yeah. It's really neat.
But yeah.
Mm-hmm. She said, you know, it wasn't a very big lake for us to be going around.
No.
That's always, do we have video of that, Stephen? I need to sit down and watch the video.
Map
of
this
show.
Out.
We don't have video of the entire show, but we do have kind of like the 1950s style commercial. The Willie Bartley ski and entertainment show.
Love it.
You know, like that kind of thing. And we do have some footage of that. And it is for a speedboat to be going around Lake Rudolph is impressive.
Well, and you see these photos it's such a small lake. And you see these photos of them stacked up in like a human pyramid on top of each other's shoulders. I'm like, where do you have the time and the room to do this?
Because they're like, they had to be constantly turning. There's no way they weren't constantly turning.
It's just a circle.
I know.
Yeah.
Guys, I attempted to like water ski like once in my life and decided that was never going to be for me.
Same.
She said she couldn't do jumps either. She was really bummed. She never was able to do jumps, but she did learn to slalom that.
I wouldn't be able to either. So.
Yeah.
I feel like I could go on the ramp. I don't know that I would land. Like that would be terrifying.
Like that would be the point where I just like let go of the handle. I'm like, whatever happens at this point happens.
I would guess nobody would watch the show anymore after that.
No, I feel like I couldn't hit a ramp. You know what I'm saying? Like, I don't even think I could hit that. Like, I would end up in the wrong place.
I
can dance. That's it.
I've wakeboarded, and I think my fear of hitting the water, like, I would be so focused on the trick and not landing it that I would not last very long. So kudos to her for making it several summers.
And especially,
awesome.
I mean, with those, I don't know we did water ski a bunch, and when we first started, my dad would only buy one pair of skis for the whole family. Mm-hmm. Well, that makes a huge difference. When I was like 5, using the same skis that my dad was using.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh.
Same thing with a life jacket. He used to tie a string around it. So if it flew off, it came up. Yeah.
So you're cheapo. A survivor is what
yes,
I'm hearing.
Seriously.
You're resilient.
And for I the learned, record, now you can bring your own life jacket to the park, but it does have to be Coast Guard approved and it does have to actually fit your child.
Exactly. Or we do have life jackets that are appropriately sized yes. for people to use.
Yes. Size appropriate.
And in the ocean. I learned how to ski in South Carolina.
Oh my wow. gosh.
Oh my gosh. That's amazing. Yes.
You're like
That's
an
so cool and also
woman.
Terrifying.
You need to write your own book.
Nell's Adventures.
Oh, yeah.
I also want to call out that in 1955, future president at the time, Ronald Reagan, visited the park.
Yeah. This General Electrics.
Yeah.
General
Electric. Could you expand on that?
Yeah, he worked for General Electric, and he was like their spokesperson. Okay.
Like their advertising. Okay. Yeah.
I feel like I see the pictures, and I just haven't had the time to dive deep into mm-hmm. like what brought him here. Interesting. Yep. They're mm-hmm. just kind of doing like a feature on...
I think he was just kind of going around. Yes, okay. And we were one of the stops.
Oh, cool.
Well, you know, I mean, Bill Cook was pretty influential in Washington, D.C. and getting mm-hmm. things done in the state. So
right. Yeah. Knew some
yeah,
people.
Yeah.
Well, and I also want to call out, too, you know, when the park starts, that takes a lot more than just, you know, nothing. We talked a little bit about the start there, too, but... without World War II,
mm-hmm.
right.
Holiday
right.
World doesn't exist the way it is today. And, you know, right. Bill Cook, you can correct me if I'm wrong. My understanding is that when Bill went off to Pearl Harbor to rebuild ships, kind of the rest of his brothers found places in the George Cook and Sons business, and there wasn't really a spot for him left when he returned.
I don't know if it
or
was.
Or did he have just a place in his heart for this place?
I think he just, I think at first he kind of came over here, just what I've read. Mm-hmm. Obviously, I haven't. Yeah. I don't know that he didn't have a spot, but okay. I don't think he was interested in that.
Interesting. Okay. But I think it's interesting to see, too, that they're such masters of publicity yeah. going through our history, mm-hmm. too.
Yeah.
Just that,
yes.
you know, they knew how to, you know, I saw an, I think, late 40s article about having, children whose parents died in war come out and like things like that, where it's like they get all this publicity going and it gets picked up in all these newspapers.
And like the kids that they could be the mayor of mm-hmm. Holiday World for a day. It was mm-hmm. like with the,
yes.
you know, they would come for the dinner at the Christmas room.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And so I think you could be the mayor, the fire chief, and
oh,
the police
cute.
Person. Mm-hmm. And then they got to like run Holiday World for the day.
mm-hmm. And even like naming the section Pleasureland
right.
was like yep. a newspaper contest.
Right.
Yeah. Right.
Just the right. way that they came up with clever ways to kind of get that earned media, which mm-hmm. now is what I'm doing. and I'm yes. like, man, to have
Full
that creativity.
Circle.
I mean,
yeah.
I like to think that maybe publicity stunts don't work the same way today as they did in like, you know, the 40s and 50s yeah. and 60s, but
a little simpler times.
Yeah.
Yeah. They did like still, pageants and like there was an yeah. Easter pageant. There was like a special
Easter pageant.
Yes. And
well,
there was,
why not?
There was like if your birthday was on Christmas Day,
yes.
there was a contest.
Yes.
And then like
if you had a name that was
yes.
like.
And they would bring in that, oh, is it Lewis Sorensen?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. They would yeah. have him come in and paint their portrait if they won.
Yeah.
Like brought him
oh,
in
that's
from
so
California.
Cool.
I was like, I wonder if those
Man.
Portraits are around.
That's a big deal.
Yeah. yeah. Mm-hmm. Literally yeah. brought him in if they won. So pretty cool.
I found a photo of Lewis Sorensen painting the mural that was in the Christmas room.
Cool.
Really?
And it's so cool to think that I got to go in and like see that before, you know, Marketplace. I mean, it had been plastered over for years and years
right.
anyway, but
right.
it's really
there.
Cool to see. I also want to call out that in the 70s, we added more kids rides, Blitzen's Airplanes, if you recall, Comet's Rockets, mm-hmm. and Prancer's Merry-Go-Round. Jim Futrell has called out, he thinks the seahorses came before all of those,
mm-hmm.
and that makes them our longest standing, or oldest operating attraction in the park right now.
Yeah.
The seahorses.
The seahorses.
The seahorses. Okay.
I've actually worked the seahorses before.
Oh,
I have.
Oh, I
have
that.
A little strapper on the waist,
yep.
and they have to help them get on and off.
Yep.
I think I have a picture with all my kids riding at
Aww,
some point, too.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I work at seahorses.
I just found a picture of Madeline on those, actually, in the ride operator asked her favorite animal. And Madeline told her something.
Yeah.
The girl, she said, the operator was being very sweet. She's like, my favorite animals or dolphins. It's my lifelong dream to swim with dolphins.
Oh.
And Madeline, like literally she was like maybe three in the picture, looks her dead in the eyes and goes, "You better not. They bite." And the poor ride operator was like, I was like, "You don't have to respond. It's okay."
She was like, "You just ruined my dream."
She just shut down your dream.
She's just like trying to be nice to a kid. Yeah. And like she just crushes your dreams casually.
Yep. Just hear me savage.
Funny.
Proud moments, I'm sure.
Yeah.
You know, okay, so we move on to 1978. We get Lewis and Clark Trail and Paul Revere's Midnight Ride. I think this is around the time that we start calling Santa Claus Land a holiday world of fun, too. So we're starting to build to that holiday world transition. Mm-hmm. And it's funny to see and very smart and clever the way they did it. Mm-hmm. So it was always Santa Claus Land. It's a holiday world of fun. In 1980, Thunder Bumpers on Chesapeake Bay was added. We know you want it back. Sorry, guys, I'm not doing it.
Never.
I feel like those poor ride operators ended up in the water a lot.
And some poor guests
ended up in the water, too. Oh, jeez. I'm fine not hearing that again. I apologize, guys, if you love it. And I'll fight every day for the Banshee with you guys. I'll be right alongside you, but...
You will never win the Thunder Bumper.
Pass on the Thunder Bumper.
Battle, ever.
Let's move on. So, 1984, of course, we changed Santa Claus Land and add Frightful Falls. You know, we had the 4th of July section and Halloween section. I don't know if I've looked at a map around that time. What was around Frightful Falls? We had the Scrambler, I assume, and Goblin Burgers.
I assume Goblin Burgers was there.
Wasn't called Goblin Burgers, though. It was called something else.
But I do think, though, that, you know, once you get past, like, 1984, the big park-changing attractions get added almost every year very quickly. So 1986, mm-hmm. the Banshee gets added. 1990, I still think that, you know, sorry to the lovers of the Banshee. It was cool. I still think that Frightful Falls and Raging Rapids were really those first indications of where we were headed.
Right.
Not that the Banshee wasn't great, but, you know, it wasn't that themed attraction the same way that Raging Rapids and Frightful Falls were.
Well, like, Raging Rapids is, like, such a perfect family ride. It's still very popular
to this day.
Yes.
Yep. Anytime I ask people what they're, like, just ask on Facebook, you know, what's your favorite attraction at the park? Every time it's Raging Rapids, hands down.
That's
you'll get
crazy.
Some Voyage lover. I mean, if you ask some enthusiasts, you'll get the Voyage and all the different, you know, coasters and stuff like that. But Raging Rapids and Frightful Falls are the winners by a long shot. And they also move more people than most of our other attractions.
Yes. Yep. True.
But it's also nice that they have kind of lower height limits as well. So
exactly. Mm-hmm. For
They're
families.
Perfect for the families. Let's see. So 1993, again, credit to Lauren for, I think that's a bigger one than I ever include in my brain because we got burnt out on water parks as children.
Yeah. A lot of family vacations leading up to 93. Well, and then even the years after, we're spent like, where can we go that there's also a water park that dad can go to and check out what they
do
have
some
and take
research.
Yes. You have no idea the number of like photo albums.
Can you hear my little kid sigh still?
That our dad had that just had photos of other parks, like landscaping.
No children.
No.
Just landscaping.
No. We were maybe in like one or two photos in an entire roll of film.
I've been guilty of that too. Tanya would say, can you at least put one of the kids in the picture so I can use it too?
Right.
Seriously. Oh, like, geez. I remember whenever I was little and I'd go into dad's office and I'd be like, oh, can I look at the pictures? And dad's like, okay. And I'm like, we're not in these.
These are boring.
And think about how much like Sawyer and like Blake love to see photos of themselves. Like if I can entertain Sawyer for an hour at least just going through old photos, like I'll literally just like filter the photos with his face and just show him photos from when he was first born.
Yes.
He is obsessed with seeing photos of himself. And just think about us poor kids who just want to see photos of ourselves.
They don't exist.
Yes, you guys had it so rough.
Yeah, I know. Yeah,
and
we
it's
were
like,
traveling around. But.
It's even better that it's film because that's even more of a commitment to
it. I know.
It.
Like, You need to understand, though, but it wasn't always like going to a water park in the dead of summer because our dad had to be here in summer. Yes. So it was like April and like 60 degrees, and dad's like, we're going to a water park. And we're like, no.
In your wetsuit.
I remember watching a water coaster go by. And I think that too is a fun part of those is that he was watching water coaster technology when we were
for
young.
Years and years and years. And he just never, he was like, it's not right.
He's like, he had been watching them in the 90s and we didn't.
It could be better. It could be better.
We did not build until the limbs came out in, you know, the later 2000. Mm-hmm. We built Wildebeest in 2010.
Yep.
It's wild to think about. But yeah, I apologize to everyone who's a water park fan. I never give it enough credit because we got worn out on those quickly. And also for the record, we had commercial shoots in like early May when like no one cared if kids' lips turned blue. They'd be like, we need more lipstick on her. Her lips are turning blue.
Yeah.
But we got a great commercial, so there you go.
And you didn't have to pay the talent.
You're included in those to make up for the pictures.
Yeah.
You can go back and watch the commercials anytime you want.
Yeah, I was going to say, go look at the commercials and you all can see yourselves.
It's your photo album.
Jeez. But yeah, even the ones that like, and we got like featured in the, well, Lauren got featured and I got radio commercials. I didn't mean to turn this into like a Leah's gripes about the world session, but here we are.
It's my
lot in life. It's fine.
It's my burden.
It's her burden over here. But yeah, no, Lauren, I feel like we got to have those commercials during the time where we were really aggressively adding on to the water park and never in the dry park.
Mm.
I will say that Liberty launch, we rode, I don't know how many times.
Well, I did get to do the one Legend coaster.
Oh yeah.
Commercial. Yeah. Because I was the teacher.
That's right.
Oh, cute.
And the classroom was my siblings and cousins.
Yeah.
Oh, too funny.
I didn't get to be on that one either.
Oh.
I thought you were in the classroom for that one.
No, I was like as tall as you.
Oh, yeah, you were. This is true.
We brought in all the cousins and friends that were like 3 years younger than me, so 5 years younger than you.
So it's fine. You were behind the camera watching. Silently crying.
Just sitting by the snack table.
Which we had good snacks, right?
Just like one tear into the carrots.
Here, Leah, have a cookie.
But yes, most of our commercials were in the water park. I think we did. Yes. We did get to do like ride. 1 year, I think we rode Howler a ridiculous number of times.
Yeah, I was actually just going to call out 99, Hall Dogs Fun Town. We did get to spend a lot of time in the dry park on that one.
We did. And there were quite a few days where Dad let us go in because he needed to test some things and we were the guinea pigs.
Mm-hmm.
So, but that wasn't a bad job.
Yeah, no, that was a pretty fun job. And I think of all the attractions and just like the timing with which he built them in conjunction with our ages, I feel like Hall Dogs Fun Town for me, that was the thing.
Aww.
Like it was like the perfect age.
That's fun.
I miss those like spinny things you could like hop on. Yeah. They had these like posts where you hopped on and like leaned out. You'd spin really slow and you pulled in tight, it'd go really fast. I could do that for hours.
Those were like favorite thing.
Yes.
And probably incredibly dangerous.
Yeah.
That's why we don't have them anymore.
Centrifugal force and such.
Kids would just go, woo, woo. Yep. I have no idea. Maybe they did. Maybe they
probably did.
They did.
Kids running into each other. I'm like envisioning
it. Oh, that's what it was. If you leaned out, if both of you were leaned out, sometimes you would not.
And we had the jumping fountains up there.
Yes. Someone posted about this in the season pass holder group the other day. And all I have to say is you ruined the magic waters.
Were they the ones sticking their face in the fountain?
Yes. Probably.
Yes.
Okay, so if you know the Hall Dogs Funtown area, you know those giant 3 planners that are, you know, about 3 feet?
Well, a little higher than waist.
Probably about 4 foot.
Yeah. 4 foot
They're
high.
Pretty tall.
They are.
Before you get to Hall Dogs.
Planters,
but not too
used
tall
to
the kids couldn't climb on them.
Dancing water fountains.
Oh.
And so the water would shoot from one to the next. And there's a whole little pattern. It was fun.
Yep.
And adults would try to like put their hand up and disrupt the stream.
Or they'd stick a cup
or
out.
Stick their face in it, all these things.
Yeah.
And then when the water starts to run out, it can't make that full loop. Oh, and yeah. So water just ended up everywhere around it and not in it, which, like, there was still probably a mistake in that, probably should have been like landscaped and fenced.
When that's
in hindsight, but
another dad memory is that I remember we always wanted to go eat whenever we would go into the park to eat with dad. We always wanted to go to Hot Diggity Dog because they had chicken fries,
which was our dad's
request.
Loved chicken fries.
Yes, so we had to go back to Hot Diggity Dog.
I never understood that.
My kids eat them to like right now
with their turly fries,
kind of mushy. Like
I don't like chicken fries. Anyway,
I like chicken fries.
But every time we would go back there, we'd go back. It feels like every single time, dad would notice that at least one of them, the water wasn't making it to the next one. And so then dad would spend the next 15, 20 minutes adjusting things. Yeah. And we'd be like, Dad, can we get in line to get our food? We're hungry.
Hold on. And there are a lot of hungry moms.
You're just standing around the broken fountain.
Well, generally mom was with us. So we'd go get in line. But yeah, dad would be over there working on the
Dad, what do you want?
Chicken fries.
It's fine. It's all fine. we kind of skipped over 1995. We discussed that already. The Raven was added. I will call out, too, that the Raven was totally intended to be a family coaster. Mm-hmm. It was not intended to be like a high-thrill attraction, and it kind of, I don't know if it was by accident or what. But
compared to all the other attractions we had at that time.
Yeah. But it turned out, I think, a little more intense than we thought it would in writing. And also, again, everyone, sorry, I was the reason the height limit got changed.
No, that's fair.
I rode with my dad, and someone asked me about the other day. I called Splashin Safari Services, and they were like, it was Emma. Everyone loves Emma. She was like, I need to hear this story. So, Emma, just in case I don't get to say hi to you again this summer, because apparently I'm glued to my computer most days. It's fine. I rode the Raven when it first was opening with my dad, and apparently I got, this is according to Paula, I got very, very scared and like shrank down in my seat, and that was when it was a single lap bar, no divider
situation. I think even a single seatbelt.
Oh, single seatbelt.
Yeah. Okay.
I think it was a single seatbelt.
It was.
I heard that you had to be held down. Like you were flying up.
Oh, I think either way, it wasn't a great experience for me.
Dad was scared by the time they got back to the station.
And that's how the height limit went from one to another. And I stand by that, the 48 inches. That's still like, there are some tiny kids that I've put on some roller coasters. I'm like, okay.
My nephew wrote it.
Wrenching those seatbelts as like tight as I can get
them. Pushing
them
lap bar down as far as it will go.
Well, my nephew wrote it. He wrote it for the first time on July 3rd with me, and he was so excited. He did the exact same thing. I thought of you. I was on the Raven. Yeah. He like was like scrunched down, and I know you can't see me, podcast listeners, but I'm scrunching down, and he had like the sweetest grin, but his tongue was out the whole time. I was like, buddy, put your tongue in.
Don't bite your tongue.
But it was like the sweetest grin, even though he was like crouched in the corner, like
just tongue hanging out.
He was like so happy. So he was finally tall enough. So.
Aww.
Yep. But I mean, I thought of you though, because he was like all scrunched down in the seat, like enjoying it, but terrified.
But yeah. And then 2000, of course, the Legend was built. To me, I think what really astounds me about that, about free unlimited soft drinks coming out the same year as the Legend, is like a roller coaster is generally a nice boost in attendance that year.
Mm-hmm.
So we didn't need a gimmick to get people to the park. We had the Legend coming, and we still went ahead and did it. I'm like, that's a move. I feel like I would have been like, let's just wait a year on the soft drinks. We've already got the coaster going. Yeah.
We'll make some money this season and pay for the coaster.
Yeah.
But like, I think it was smart, though, because it really does kind of kickstart your growth. Mm-hmm. And, you know, people start to go, oh, we got to come back again next year. This isn't just an every other year or every, you know, once a childhood situation. We got to go back now. I think it was really clever, and you know, I would like to think that I would also actually stack them together, but you know,
now that they got
I feel like I would have to think it through and analyze that one a lot.
But now we have a good data point from the past to show that does work.
Yeah. Exactly. We also, 2002, I want to call out Zimbabwe is still the tallest enclosed raft slide. There are taller water slides that exist and are enclosed, but most of them are those drop rides that where like the floor drops out from under you. So also our ride experience is probably longer than any of those taller attractions for the record. So they make taller ones than that, but the only one that you can ride on a raft still, according to my research, as of like 2 years ago. I also, I have to call out Zynga as well, because Lauren and I could have had a hand in picking Zynga and decided not to. Do you recall this? Okay, so we had videos of both the type of slide that Bakuli is and the Zynga, except the Zynga didn't exist anywhere.
Okay.
And so the video we had for that was like a giant, like funnel, not giant, but like a several foot funnel, and a video of an engineer or Rick or someone at Pro Slide with like a little like marble and washer, and it was rolling through the model, and it showed how it worked, but I couldn't see a pretty brightly colored slide in it.
Yeah.
And so Dad tried to concept test this with us and tried to ask us, do we want the bull ride or do we want this new ride that no one's ever built before? And I think he thought he knew what we were going to pick. And we were like, the toilet bowl, which now I'm like, oh, don't call it the toilet bowl. But, you know.
What's funny, have you seen the TikTok videos that have like the cleaning tutorials and they're pink and purple? So it's like literally, I think of that every time now.
The Zynga is my favorite water slide in Splashin Safari.
It's really fun.
I love that one.
I've been on it a few, I guess, more traumatizing times.
The toilet bowl.
Before we had scales at the top.
Yes.
Okay, the scales at the tops of water slides are for your safety, everybody.
Exactly.
That's 1,000% all I have to say about that.
1,000%.
Yep.
I remember we had an exchange group from Florida come here. I feel like they're from Jacksonville. So, like, these kids grew up going to, like, Disney and Universal. And, like, they thought, like, they probably thought they were going to a county fair when we're like, we're going to Holiday World. Like, all these Southern Indiana kids are super excited. Mm-hmm. And these Florida kids are like, well, okay, we're going to a theme park. And like that's one of the rides we took them on, and they were like mind blown. Like they were like, this place is legit. Like all of Holiday World didn't convince you, but okay. But I remember that being one like in line, and then like we rode it, and they were like super impressed.
I mean, it was the first of its kind, and we didn't have the vision yet.
Yeah.
And
let me clarify by traumatizing. Nothing bad happened. It was just very heavy.
It was very
raft.
Intense.
It was a very heavy raft, and I ended up going backwards. Mm.
Oh, that can be scary.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you can hit some good heights on that funnel.
We did.
They were reached.
I've had fun times, though, on the. I mean, I loved that ride. But yeah, anyway. Moving on. Some other big moves. Bahari Wave Pool being added, I think, is still a huge thing, because who would have guessed? I feel like most water parks, you know, they've got their one wave pool, and that's fine. We need them.
Yeah.
We put so many people in the water park, and we hear about it when one of them is closed, let alone, guys, water quality is important and water safety is important. Sometimes young guests have accidents in the pool, and there's nothing we can do about those rules. We have to keep you safe. Sorry.
And the free unlimited sunscreen goes somewhere.
The free unlimited soft drink goes some or sunscreen.
Sunscreen.
Oh, maybe some soft drinks too. I don't know. Maybe
those can cloud the pool, and our lifeguards need to see the bottom of the pool as well, guys. So,
yes, once you apply your free sunscreen, please give it a little bit of time to dry.
Yes,
before you
get in the water, please.
Yeah, just use it though.
Yeah, but yes, use it and apply frequently.
Yes, my goodness,
once is not enough.
No.
And then, I mean, we kind of skipped over it, too. 2006, the entire Thanksgiving section comes around, too. Mm-hmm. I'm going to call that one out because that was huge for us, not only, for the voyage and for, you know, just the kind of national attention that came to us, but also operationally that we changed from the tiny building for our employee services.
Yes. Yep.
I think we had to increase our employees by each year so quickly that we just had... We were still making this tiny building work for us. And that
section added substantially to our need for employees, too.
Yes.
That's what I was going to say. I never thought about that.
It was a restaurant and some snack stands and several attractions. Yeah. And it's like,
If I recall correctly, 2000, we were at around 500,000 in attendance. And by 2006, we broke 1 million in attendance.
So where was the HR? Where was everybody?
The print shop.
No way.
Yes, yeah,
way.
It was like a very tiny amount that like actual employees used.
Yeah, there was maybe like 10, 12 foot wide hallway from like, and you just, you literally, you would walk
in, got your,
your time card, swiped it, get your money bag if you needed it, and then you walked out. There was no standing around.
Nope.
And that was just employee services.
And we transported money bags from down there back up in a truck.
Yep.
But
and then you had to
do that.
Then you had to walk up and down the Raging Rapids Hill all day. That was the hill that you entered and exited from.
Unless you had a job in Splashin Safari.
Sorry. Okay, well, I always had to hoof it up that hill every day.
On a right-hand turn and walked your way to...
Yeah, HR was two people, and they were also the reception slash HR.
Yeah.
And so...
And call center. So, all in one.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Then,
so they took all calls.
Huge. Wow.
The period of time between 2000 to 2006, I think we kind of, you know, we gloss over it sometimes in our memories, but...
Wow, that's expansion. Huge.
I mean, we doubled our annual attendance during that time.
Wild.
I think when I first started, we had maybe 7 directors total. We now have 22.
Yeah.
Wow.
And I mean, we just kept having to add, you know, people to operate rides. We kept having to add all kinds of things. It's wild how much we added and so quickly, and that it took us over the top. And also, I have to say that, like, I'm happy to see that Gobbler Getaway is becoming the new, like, Raging Rapids in terms of, like, belovedness.
Mm-hmm. Just because it's air conditioned. That's why I liked it.
It's like the perfect family ride.
It is.
I don't know why, but I just feel like it's always been a little underappreciated. Mm-hmm. And just recently, I feel like we've been seeing tons of love for it. And I'm like, it really is a good ride. Mm-hmm. It's such a fun.
I like that ride.
Cute, dark ride.
Themed very well.
And you get to do, you know, you get to call your turkeys and you get to rack up the points. And we ask the season pass holders every now and then in their Facebook group, you know, what's the highest score you've ever gotten?
Oh, that's fun.
Some of them cheat when there's ride stalls, but
I said I'm embarrassed to post mine.
Mine's
I've had several
good.
Rounds where like I can't break 100, so
yeah. I never do all that well.
No.
But props to those of you who do.
I feel like there's some technique you're not sharing, but props.
Yeah. Well, I will also say too that like I'm always like the caller was bad on mine.
Yeah, and our tested every day.
Test some everyone every day. So no, I've got no excuse.
I've ridden some days and I'd be like, oh well, I just got a bad one, and then I'm like, no, we test them.
You're the bad one.
Yeah,
I clearly am not good.
Consistently, I get a bad caller every time. I don't know how that works.
It's not me.
It's not me. Yeah.
No.
It can't be me.
No, never.
But yeah, I mean, we can look at all the other stuff. And, you know, of course, I want to call out 2015. We added Thunderbird, which still was a huge thing for us. But yeah, I mean, there are so many small things to think about. And, you know, we didn't even talk about, you know, Bill Cook advocating, lobbying for 64 to get moved closer to us. That's huge.
That was huge.
If it's difficult to find your park, no one's coming.
Right.
Especially in a world of just maps. And that's the only way that you can, you know, find this place.
Yes. It's huge.
It's brilliant. And, you know, he adds Christmas Lake Village. That was huge. We finally had, you know, I think originally we had like 80 something people in the town before Santa Claus Land started. So to get it up to even today's full 2,500,
hey,
it takes some vision. And, you know, we still have a fair amount of kids from, you know, Christmas Lake Village who work at the park because it's just conveniently located.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. You know, there's so many things like that. But again, I think also it's fun to see what masters they were of publicity as well. You know, the free unlimited soft drinks. Total move that, you know, gets you a ton of publicity, also improves the guest experience, and also, you know, brings people to the park, but it's such a good way to garner attention as well. I just, they're pretty cool people, I guess, who went before us. They kind of knew some things.
Yeah. You know.
Not a bad job.
Yeah, they did all right. They got us to 75 years.
They did.
Yeah.
We helped.
And now, Yeah. And now Lauren and I are, and William, sometimes when he's not in New York, being more glamorous than us, do our best to carry on that vision.
Want to make a suggestion or have questions for the Pod Squad? There are more ways than ever to reach out to the podcast.
Find at Holiday World on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, and use the hashtag HOWOPO to let us know you're talking about us.
You can now call us. Dial 812-937-4401 and type in extension 8081 to get to the HOWOPO voicemail box.
Leave your questions and feedback for us there, or you can email us at podcast@holidayworld.com, either with a written message or with a voice memo.
Again, reach out on social media to @HolidayWorld and use the hashtag HOWOPO, or call us at 812-937-4401, extension 8081, or send us an email to podcast@holidayworld.com.
Mom, Ethan's in the tree again.
Ethan, get down.
Can I climb on the swing set instead?
Sounds like it's time to get all your adventure-seeking kids to Holiday World and Splashin Safari. They'll soar on Thunderbird, race against each other on Cheetah Chase, the first launched water coaster, and get the thrills they love on all the wooden roller coasters. Get your family fun off the ground at HolidayWorld.com.
I want to call out some holidays because we are Holiday World and we love holidays. July 22nd is National Water Coaster Day. So we're waiting for Wildebeest to hit 1 million cycles, which it has already done now, because we're
in the future.
We're in the future now.
Cool.
And so we have officially created our own holiday, because if everyone else can have one, so can we. Gosh darn it.
It's Wildebeest Day on one of those days.
It is National Water Coaster Day.
Let's make it National Wildebeest Day.
I want to have like National Water Coaster Day. Right. Though. I think it's a
if we're going to create a holiday, let's not be way too specific. We're trying to get rid of like National
Corgi
Day.
We're going to have to create National Mammoth Day, National Voyage Day, National Thunderbird Day, and
it's exhausting.
I think they're probably
particularly preposterous packaging day.
Yeah.
Can we get rid of that?
I'm not even
jumping ahead, sorry.
Come on. Okay, so we just talked about, you know, National Water Coaster Day, our first ever made-up holiday. We wanted to give you a little taste of what the actual day was like, so here's some audio from that event.
Ladies and gentlemen, this next family here is our millionth vote on Wildebeest.
First of all, could you guys tell me your names?
I'm Angel.
I'm Micaiah.
And my name is Carter.
I can't believe that it is your birthday on the day you're on the millionth boat on Wildebeest. Well, congratulations on being on the millionth boat. How's it feel?
Good.
We have quick access passes for each of you. So you guys get front of the line access. Just go up the exit on any of the water coasters or any of the dry park rides. And you get four of those today, and they're valid for four people each. So we have some signs for you guys as well. Can we take a photo with you guys? We've got a big sign here. Awesome. Thank you so much. And we have little keepsake signs for you as well to remember the event.
Thank you. That's awesome.
It's our pleasure. Have a great day. We won't keep you for too long. Get back to the fun. Happy National Water Coaster Day, everybody.
Go ride a coast.
From the person who has brought to you National Consolidate a Holiday Day.
There you go.
I'm adding one.
There you go.
Put aside, we need to own that one. Anyway, moving on. July 26th is Aunt and Uncle Day. I believe this came on a series of relatives from the last episode.
Yes. That does ring a bell.
If you haven't already, just go ahead and, you know, thank everybody in your family. Show your appreciation to everybody in your family, because if you're not, you're probably being a jerk. So I think this is what not we're going to learn with all these holidays. There are more holidays coming up still that are family related. And it's like, yeah, guys, you should probably just be nice to your family on any day.
Yeah.
But July 29th is intern day. I just want to shout out to Landon and Chris. And I'm trying to think of all of our intern. Max. Thank you.
We have Megan up in accounting.
Megan in accounting. Thank you. Do we have? I'm sure we've got more out there.
Brandon's
mark. We've been expanding
daughter
a lot.
Has been in the call center. What's her name?
Josie.
And then we have an HR. Is it Hannah and...
I'm going blank.
Brandon might be his name. They both worked really hard. They helped me help a guest one day.
I think
they
it's
were
Logan.
Amazing. Logan.
That's awesome. Thank
okay.
you.
Can you dub over that, Stephen? Logan
sure.
was Logan and Hannah.
I'll start working on it now. For
Logan and Hannah were amazing in HR. So, and I'm sure they have others that I haven't met.
Yep.
Stephen, just take our past podcast and just put together a bunch of words.
Yeah. I'm just really anxious to hear Hannah and Logan.
Hannah and Logan.
Actually, I was going to say, what I really want is Hannah and Stephen coming in.
Logan.
That's deep.
It's like the old school voicemail. Like, yes. Hello, you have reached the voicemail box of
Ellen. Yeah. I love that one.
Lauren Crosby.
Yeah. July 29th, also, thank you to all of our interns. Want to call that out again.
Mm-hmm.
Y'all have been great all summer, and we do post internships in the spring, so look out for that. July 30th is Share a Hug Day, and I think I called this out last year, and I just want to say what a nice world it is that we can hug people again within a certain amount of caution still, but we can hug people again.
I was not a hugger before. Wasn't really fond of hugs. And then I had someone like that, one of our media friends that gave me a hug. And I was like, that was the best hug I've ever had. It was like my first non-familial hug that I had had.
Was it Chad?
It was Chad. Yep. Yeah. It was
Chad's
amazing.
A hugger.
Chad gives good hugs too. Yeah.
Chad and Angel came up. They're like, can we hug? Are we vaccinated? I'm like, I am.
We are. Yes.
I was like crying over a hug. Sorry.
Please hug me.
Please hug me. I am
you don't know what you've got until it's gone.
Right.
You know what I'm saying?
Right. I am sufficiently hugged by my family, but there was something about, you know, that first hug.
A foreigner.
Yeah. All the way from Kentucky. Yeah.
A poor hug.
July 30th is also Talking an Elevator Day. So I feel like this is all the days that you can't have with COVID. So hooray, we're beyond it.
Just don't hug in an elevator day. Or I guess you can because it's on the same day.
Or share cheesecake.
Also, if you're not vaccinated, maybe consider that before you do any of these.
Right.
all right. July 30th is also Cheesecake Day.
I can get behind that.
Which I called out very specifically for Matt B because I enjoy getting him on a cheesecake rant.
I love
cheesecake.
He's
not here today.
Rude. Does he not like it?
No.
Oh, no.
Okay.
That is not the problem.
He loves cheesecake, but it has to be plain.
Oh,
it's
no.
No toppings.
Specific kind of cheesecake.
No.
With no garnishments.
No. None.
No.
None.
I like plain cheesecake.
Do not put fruit on Matt's cheesecake. That is a recipe for disaster.
I kind of had to back him on that.
No.
Yeah, I mean, you know,
he can maybe
to go
do
with,
like a chocolate drizzle. He doesn't care for it.
He
but
goes
he can
to the Cheesecake Factory, and every time I have yet to see him go to the Cheesecake Factory and get anything but plain.
No, that's what I was going to say.
I've got caramel apple cheesecake there. That is the best.
I know. That's the Cheesecake Factory.
So
I mean, like,
okay.
You normally like you get something different like every time. No.
Can
plain
I confess something?
Every time.
I have tried to bait Matt into switching cheesecakes at the Cheesecake Factory. So I know Matt also has like a weak spot for chocolate mousse. And so I got the chocolate mousse cheesecake. High recommend from Cheesecake Factory, by the way. Cheesecake Factory, would you like to advertise with us?
Yes.
We will accept payment in cheesecakes.
Yes, I like peanut butter.
We will taste your cheesecake
that's
on air.
That's one of the few restaurants all members of my family like.
I mean, they only have like 10,000 menu items.
Right.
So.
Like exactly.
The
that's
worst.
Why it's one of the only restaurants
that's awesome.
All of my family
it
like.
It has like the most calories of any place on the planet.
Well, you know, it's worth it.
Oh, gosh. True.
It's worth it.
Familial satisfaction. Worth it.
But yeah, I know. I tried to bait Matt with it, and I think I got him to try a bite of the chocolate mousse cheesecake. He was like, I'm good. Anyway.
I think it's in his head. He's just being stubborn and won't.
He's a blindfolded.
They used to have jalapeno cheesecake where we lived in Texas.
No, that's not.
That's like the most Texas thing I think
I've
ever
heard. Pretty good. Can I confess a different thing that is bad? I don't necessarily like love cheesecake.
Oh.
Like I'll do like the Cheesecake Factory. Like I chocolate chip cookie dough cheesecake is my favorite, but they've been hit or miss with that lately. And that's very upsetting to me. That's a different topic I would like to talk about. Thank you for coming to my TED Talk.
Dave's not a big cheesecake person either, so I can never spoil it.
Do you like key lime pie?
Yeah.
You should try the key lime cheesecake.
Ooh.
It's really good too.
Cheesecake isn't always my favorite, but I think I've found there at least a Cheesecake Factory. Again, sponsor us, please. Yeah. they're like, it's like the lemon raspberry or raspberry lemon, whatever it is. Oh, that one.
Pretty good.
See, I found one that hits my sweet spot, and that is that they also have a chocolate cake that is bomb at Cheesecake Factory.
It's huge.
That Linda's chocolate cake.
It's huge.
It's where it's at.
It's like 17
layers
tall.
And just in case
you
needed more calories at the Cheesecake Factory, I believe that has even more calories than a regular slice of cheesecake. So,
oh, gosh.
I know how to do it.
I mean, go big or go home.
But they have a like celebration cheesecake right now that is layers of the chocolate cake and cheesecake. Ooh. And that is where... Guys, go to Cheesecake Factory.
Can we go there after
Tell
this?
Tell them Leah sent you.
Recording.
They will have no idea what you mean.
I am not a brand rep. This is my pitch.
July 30th is also Friendship Day, so Cheesecake Factory, be friends with us. Thanks, bye. August 3rd is obviously our birthday.
Yeah.
Woo-hoo. 75, baby. I'm sad that I haven't, like, somewhere around the beginning of the season, I've been waiting for someone to give us, like, a good insult. So I could be like, respect your elders. We're 75 years old. No one has done it yet.
Sucks.
I'm just waiting for it. Upon hearing this, I can think of at least three accounts that are going to tweet something vaguely rude at us. And then I won't remember that we recorded this. Yeah. So it's going to be a fun time. It's also White Wine Day, so plan accordingly.
Okay.
For after the park, you know?
The after party.
August 4th is Coast Guard Day. Just want to say thank you for your service.
Thank you.
Don't forget that we have a military discount.
John Atkins is the Coast Guard?
Yep. Absolutely. John Atkins, our director of safety
and security.
Safety and security. He's awesome.
Yes.
Yes.
I would not want to mess with John Atkins. That's all I'm saying.
He's like the most chill person, too.
Yeah.
Like when Leah says that, like, we'll be in an extremely stressful situation and is cool as a cucumber.
That's John.
And has the coolest of stories. Like,
yes.
Oh, yeah.
He has just some stories. That,
yeah.
Yeah.
Thank you, John, for what you do.
I will still never forget Sabrina and I trying to plan for back before, you know, we knew what COVID was going to entail, planning for Media Day. Because Chia Chase was supposed to open in like early May, and we looked up the average temp was like 70 something degrees for that day. We were like, if we have a cold snap, we can't put anybody on the ride.
Yeah.
I mean, like, what do we do? And we were asking about wetsuits, and John, his response was, the body can survive for 15 minutes in a wetsuit. I was like, you mean it doesn't like keep you warm? And he's like, No, that's not what a wetsuit.
Not a warm suit. It's a wetsuit.
It's a don't die suit.
Right.
I was like, or like a don't get hypothermia suit. And I'm like, so never mind. We're going to postpone the media event if it gets too cold. Got it. The body can survive.
Yeah.
I was like, cancel that play. And he went on and explained all about wetsuits and like what level and how long your body can survive and different. I was like, no, that's quite all right.
Yeah.
We were all set once you started the sentence with, well, the body can survive. I'm like, never mind. That was a poor decision and where I regretted it immediately. Of course, as Matt tried to hint at, August 7th is particularly preposterous packaging day.
Sorry, I read ahead.
I also literally put that in because there is nothing that makes me angrier in this world.
I'm sorry. That's just
those,
the dumbest
thing ever. Those like clamshell packaging too that like slices your hand open and like.
Can we just talk about every children's toy
ever?
Yes. Yeah.
What's with all the like wires and stuff?
Or
like,
anything from Amazon.
You have to have scissors and a grenade.
Yeah.
And
they're hands. Safe for children except for the packaging.
It looks great
all
on the
shelf.
All
these like tiny wires and zip ties that come off, and the kid is around, and you got to worry about them picking stuff up and putting it in their mouth.
Nope.
It's like, what? What?
After Christmas, your hands are just sore from a day of getting plastic out of plastic.
I don't understand it.
But it does.
My favorite is that there is actually like a a utensil that has been created. It's one of those as seen on TV things. It's supposed to make it easy to cut the clamshell packaging. Guess what it's sold in? Yes. If that's not the oversight of the century.
That's funny.
That's how scissors ironic? Come.
Yes.
Yeah, that's true.
I'm like, how are you supposed to get into scissors? You need scissors to get to the scissor.
What if it's your first pair of scissors?
I know.
Now I feel like a savage. I just get a knife out of my knife drawer. I'm like, that's an easily solved problem. You stab it.
Please don't do that at home, kids.
Now I know all my knives are dull, but preposterous packaging day makes me think about our boxes now.
Particularly.
That, yeah.
Preposterous.
Not particularly preposterous. Why I can't talk.
Preposterous in like a fun way.
Yes. We have new packaging that our marketing team has made for if you buy something from the Hollis shop or like different items that you get shipped to your house. Now they have like a gingerbread house for Christmas. Like
they're all decoratable boxes.
Yeah, that's fun.
Like your kids can color them.
So there's a gingerbread house one.
Yes.
There's like a jack-o'-lantern one for Halloween.
Thanksgiving.
Oh, that's fun.
You do like hand turkeys.
Yes.
Very cute. So not preposterous.
I mean, it's like, it's preposterous considering
particularly
like,
preposterous.
It's on brand.
I mean, like it's like, yeah. It's like in the like over the top. We're, yeah.
Happily unusual packaging.
Quirky.
Quirky. Yeah. There you go. Quirky
maybe perks. We need a different holiday for that one. Just really cool packaging day.
There's probably a day for that.
Probably.
Yeah. Well, what am I thinking? August 8th is International Cat Day, and I do want to celebrate that one for Kitty Claus.
Very nice.
We should always celebrate Kitty Claus.
We have a cat that came from Holiday World, just found last week. Her name is Sammy. Sammy was left in the Legend Lot. This is our second one from the Legend Lot.
Hey, a certain amount of cats around property actually helps keep mice
for
away.
Sure.
Helps, you know.
Yep.
And we do try to take care of the cats when we find them, but, you know, we also like to find them good homes as well.
Yes. My husband walked in and they said, do you want a cat? So now she's at our house.
That's a tradition of the director of sales right there.
That's
Mike Johannes.
That's what they told Dave.
Placed a cat
that.
With us.
Well,
that is
but
so
I guess
true.
It's a proud tradition used to do now. That, though, too.
What?
Yeah. That Mike used to take cats all the time.
He did.
Yeah. I didn't know that. Yeah, someone said, you're just going to be like Mike.
That's how we got our cat.
Said they told him.
Aww.
Belle.
Our one and only cat until Leah kept running really high fevers.
Oh, shucks.
The doctor said it had nothing to do with the cat, but we got rid of the cat,
and
I stopped
the fever stopped.
Sick.
Oh.
So I think I'm just a person where allergies manifest in a weird way.
Huh.
See, mine finally went away. We got a cat last year. Not the cat, my allergy.
Oh. That's why I was like, what is she saying?
Thank you for listening, and that's the podcast.
No, my allergy.
Steven just like disappeared. He leaned back so far. Look, he was like that. He's gone.
That's like Matt in the liquidating. Yeah. I was like, what? You shouldn't say that.
She liquidated her cat.
Exactly.
It's okay, Sabrina.
This is a safe place. Oh, God.
We don't judge.
No, the cat didn't get liquidated. Why this whole podcast process is so painful. We have no fun making it.
Okay, Leah. Bring it on home.
Congratulations. This is the end of another episode. I'm not even putting a word in there. I don't even know how to describe it. Please join us in 2 weeks during your next commute, cleaning session, etc. for our next episode, season 3, episode 15, the one with the amusing historian. Thank you to all of our behind the scenes pod squad. I can't talk anymore, so this is a good day for me to be a pro. Steven, Josh, and Sabrina. Well, Josh isn't here. But words don't do it justice. You guys are amazing. Thank you.
Oh.
And thanks to all of you for continuing to listen and interact. If you're looking for ways to support Holiday World and Ho-Wo-Po, be sure to subscribe and tell all your theme park loving friends. And also maybe cheesecake loving friends at this point. And rate us if you have that option. We want to hear your feedback and would love to hear anyone else's voices except for ours. So please call us at 812-937-4401, then dial 8081 to get Stephen's long but informative instructions. Thank you to all the listeners we hear from regularly. It really means a lot to us. Share your feedback with us at podcasts@holidayworld.com or reach out to us on social media, but especially Twitter, using the hashtag
HoWoPo.
This has been Season 3 of the official Holiday World podcast, a production of Holiday World and Splashin Safari in Santa Claus, Indiana. Listen to the latest episodes and subscribe at holidayworld.com/podcast. Thanks for being a part of our story as we celebrate 75 years of family fun.
Families, they hand down things like antique bird cages.
Thanks.
In others, a long forgotten accordion. But for the past 75 years at Holiday World and Splash and Safari, we've passed down the love of family fun in the form of roller coasters, water rides, and unlimited smiles.
Awesome! Let's go now!
Get tickets at holidayworld.com.
Great!